to Disney Odd Pod.
I'm Kat.
I'm Dee.
And this week, it's the original Disney dating show. You have 3 days to make your man fall in love with you. Don't let him know you're a fish.
The Little Mermaid from 1989.
For over 50 years, Walt Disney has turned classic stories into classic animated motion pictures. Now the tradition continues as one of the world's greatest stories becomes the newest Disney motion picture classic. The Little Mermaid.
I want to be where the people are.
Wow. Got Debbie Gibson over here.
You mean Jodie Benson?
Sure.
I am curious what you thought about this movie because you haven't seen it in so long.
It's a fun movie. It's got fun songs. But I remembered quickly that this movie is kind of boring and really just very much at the surface.
Correct, sir.
There's not a whole lot of, you know, you just scratch down a little. There's nothing there.
I mean, I will say
it's very tropey.
Let me, first of all, I do still love this movie.
It's still good. Don't get me wrong.
Every little girl especially loves this movie.
Right, and I think that's the thing. I think this movie is way more for girls than anybody else. More than almost any Disney movie that I can think of, other than Enchanted.
So when I was a kid, this was my favorite Disney movie, no contest, all about it.
Well, undoubtedly, this had to be their biggest marketing thing, because they sold more merch for this movie than anything I have ever seen. I mean, there was just Ariel and Little Mermaid, everything.
It's really... So it's interesting that it was my favorite, hands down, for so long.
And I still really like the Dark Ride.
But, well, yeah, the Dark Ride is great. It's very... I still really like it, but it's very... There are, like, 4 90s Disney movies already that are better. I mean, 4 or 5, really, that are...
Well, this is the 80s, but still.
Well... Okay, November 1989. It's basically 1990.
So the next movie is Beauty and the Beast, right?
I believe so. So this movie was right after Oliver and Company.
Oh, yeah. You think?
It makes sense why it's a classic, because it's the first of the, you know, the new...
Of the good ones.
Of the good Disney formula, but it's definitely not as good as I thought it was when I was a kid.
No.
I still love it. I still love the movie because I think the soundtrack is... All the songs are great in this movie.
Well, that's the salvation of the movie, is the songs. And Ursula.
Yes, hurry home, princess. We wouldn't want to miss old daddy's celebration, now would we? Ha! Celebration indeed. Bah!
Yeah, she's... pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Right, really good. And it's just a feel-good movie. Like, you feel good after watching it.
Sure,
like,
I'm not upset after watching it at all. I'm not like, oh, man, what the fuck?
Oh, my God, Little Mermaid. Fuck this fish.
So why don't you hit that synopsis?
Okay, The Little Mermaid from 1989. Romance, family, fantasy, animation, musical. And it is on Disney Plus, obviously, along with the second and the third and all of the other TV show.
Let's not talk about those.
Ariel, the fun-loving and mischievous mermaid, is enchanted with all things human. Disregarding her father's order to stay away from the world above the sea, she swims to the surface and, in a raging storm, rescues the prince of her dreams. Determined to be human, she strikes a bargain with the devious sea witch Ursula and trades her fins and beautiful voice for legs. With her best friend, the adorable and chatty flounder, and her reluctant chaperone, Sebastian, the hilarious reggae-singing Caribbean crab, at her side, Ariel must win the prince's love and save her father's kingdom, all in a heart-pounding race against time. Contains tobacco description.
You know, flounder is the most disappointing character in this thing.
He really is.
He has, like, almost nothing to do with it.
Yeah, he's kind of a nothing. I mean, he's cute. Like, he's a cute character.
I think that's the whole thing, is that he looks good on merch.
Yeah, he looks good on merch. He's a cute character.
But he doesn't... He almost says nothing.
Yeah, he doesn't do much.
The only point of the plot that he's really important for is towing the barrel.
And yeah, I think I may be coming down with something. Yeah, I got this cough.
pretty much, yeah. And almost getting early eaten by a shark at the beginning, so.
I guess. Was that really his fault? It seems more like her.
Yeah, he's so fat, he can't fit through the little porthole.
It's just how he's shaped. He's not fat.
He's flounderish.
Well, he's not at all flounderish, but.
So, this movie, obviously, it's, you know, the dream team.
Ron Clements and John Musker of Hercules, Aladdin, Moana, Princess and the Frog, Great Mouse Detective fame.
And Treasure Planet.
Oh, let's not forget that gem. Hey. If you would have never said that, I would have never remembered that movie existed.
Hey. It was better than people gave it credit for.
It was better than Muppet Treasure Island.
It was better than Muppet Treasure Island, yes. But no, I mean, that's Aladdin, Hercules, Princess and the Frog, Moana. I mean, we have conflicting opinions on Great Mouse Detective, but they're all great movies.
Well, so let's just skip down because of the writers for all the same things, except the other thing that we need to add that they didn't direct is that they both wrote The Black Cauldron. Oh
my God. No, God! No, God, please, no! No! No!
Talk so about they learning from your mistake.
Yeah, then went from The Black Cauldron to this.
No. It's a Great Mouse Detective.
Yeah, The Great Mouse.
Yeah, so they kind of built.
Yeah.
And I mean, The Great Mouse Detective is not bad. I didn't like it as much, but I like it more the more time. Wait, is that Ratigan?
Yeah, that's Ratigan.
I like it better as time goes by.
And they developed, really all these 90s movies have the same formula.
Totally.
They all have music. They all have some sort of snappy sidekick of some time.
The funny thing is that this is almost more Lion King than it is like Aladdin because, you know, they run away during a song. It's just like a more condensed version of the Lion King.
Sure. Yeah. No, I can see where you'd say that. Yeah. That makes sense. And then they all have like a great, amazing villain and all basically the character wants something that they don't have. And it's the same, relatively the same story in all these different movies.
And it works.
But it works. So that's why they're great.
So then our actors are almost barely worth talking about. This is just like a voice cast that doesn't do much else. This is every single person that's in this. This is their main claim to fame.
That's true. I mean, Jodie Benson literally has made a career out of being Ariel.
She's just Ariel, and she got to be Barbie in Toy Story 3.
And Toy Story 2.
Okay.
Yeah. Which actually is, in Toy Story 2, is a super, super funny part of the movie. Yeah,
okay, there you go.
I'm tour guide Barbie!
The Samuel Wright, who was Sebastian, he played something called Kron in Disney's Dinosaur.
Yeah.
So we will see that.
Which I have seen.
Chris Barnes, who's Eric.
Greg Brady.
Yeah, Greg Brady and all the remake Brady stuff, which is horrible. Oh my God, that's so bad.
It's pretty bad.
Pat Carroll, who is Ursula. But she was in Bridesmaids, and she's done a ton of bit parts.
Yeah, she was a TV actor for, like, years and years and years and years, and she is amazing.
And she was in some live-action, non-Disney Cinderella movie in the 60s as one of the sisters, I think.
Interesting.
Yeah, just random, right?
Yeah, totally random. Well, and then Buddy Hackett is Scuttle.
Well, yeah.
I mean, he's probably the other biggest name in this movie at the time, probably, because he was in Love Bug. Yeah, Herbie.
And, oh, yeah, Love Bug, not Herbie. Yeah.
You know, Mad World.
Mad World.
And he was a comedian. So he was probably the biggest name, I think, at the time.
Wow. This is special. This is very, very unusual.
What? What is it?
It's a dinglehopper.
Oh, but then, small part. So, do you remember the, like, she's like the maid servant or whatever in the house, Carlotta.
Oh yeah, she's that lady. I saw that. Yeah. But this lady is this lady and everything. Yeah. I love that lady.
But she's in Ferris Bueller as like the principal's assistant. Yeah. She's great and she's just a little bit part, but her voice is very recognizable when you realize it's her. Edie McClurg.
McClurg. So, what do you got for fun facts? There was so much in this movie, it was almost hard to disseminate.
It was, and I have a few. I tried to narrow it down.
I stuck to four.
I have four also.
Oh, there you go.
Jim Carrey auditioned for the role of Prince Eric.
Right? That's, that would be something, that would be. I have the Mickey, Goofy, Donald Duck, and Kermit the Frog were hidden in the opening scene with
King Triton. We'll have to go back and look.
Yeah, we'll have to look now and see if we can find them. Yeah.
Where's Waldo?
Where's Kermit the Frog?
The type of creature that Ursula is called a cicalia. That's the half-human, half-octopus. I probably am pronouncing that wrong, but that's what it's called.
I have that Jeffrey Katzenberg wanted to cut part of your world.
So I had that one too, and the backstory on that is that Jody Benson was like, yo, producers, this is what this dude is trying to do.
That's not what I read. Well, that's interesting. What I read is that the animators were the ones that were like, well, no, you
it was
can't
the,
do it.
It was the animators telling him no, but Jody Benson went and told the producer, Mr. What's his face? Hey, this is what he's trying to do. And he was like, no, you can't do that. If you do that, it basically ruins the whole movie.
Right.
And they were right, in my opinion.
And all he wanted to do was go to make Shrek.
Ariel was specifically made a redhead to distinguish her from Daryl Hannah's character in Splash, because it came out like right when they were making this movie.
Oh, that was a good choice anyways. This is the first Disney princess with cleavage and a bare midriff. That was specifically pointed out. So I thought I'd throw it in there.
With cleavage. Okay. Okay. Ariel's Partier World Star song started the Disney formula of the I Want song.
Did you say World Star in there? Was there a World Star moment in this movie?
No.
I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding.
But it started the formula. So, like, the Belle song and Beauty and the Beast, One Jump Ahead and Aladdin, Just Can't Wait to Be King, Just Around the River Bend, Go the Distance, etc., etc.
Just can't wait to be king.
Yeah, it started that formula because they were like, oh, this works really well. And Mr. Stupid Katzenberg wanted to cut it like an idiot.
Yeah, because he is an idiot. And then I have that Ursula was based on John Waters' drag character, Divine.
I mean,
which okay. is obvious.
And just real quick, when I was thinking about that, so, because they're doing the remake, right? And they're having Melissa McCarthy play Ursula. Why wouldn't they have a drag queen play Ursula? It would make so much more sense.
It would be good. It'd be good.
Because that's what she is. It's a drag queen. Like, that's her character. And it just would be so much better if they did that.
Even though one of the things I read suggested that she was Triton's sister.
What kind of fucked up family do they have if they have, like, an octopus?
Well, that would actually make sense because he kicked her out of the castle. Like, how was she in the castle before?
I don't know. There's no explanation.
Yeah. One of the things they could have,
explained a little bit. I think they do explain it in, like, the Disney TV show, but I don't remember.
That's not going to cut it. So let's get through this.
Let's swim through it.
Yeah.
I actually completely forgot about the opening of this movie. I forgot it was a thing.
What? Which part were they talking on the ship about? No. Oh, there's a whole underworld sea. Mar, 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 mar.
Yeah, and the song, The Fathoms Below, they're all singing about the mer people and stuff, and Grimsby's like vomiting over the edge of the ship. I just forgot this whole thing existed.
So, you know, I forgot that I'd really even seen this movie. But as soon as we started watching, I was like, oh, yeah, I remember it. I thought this was a chick movie. And the only thing that I could ever really remember about this movie was...
Well, now you know there's more songs. So.
Well, only one of them is okay.
Hard disagree, but that's fine. It's fine. There's like weird animation when they go down below that it's like blurry. Okay.
It's not great. I don't know how this ended up being such a successful movie with how shitty the beginning
but,
is.
I mean, I think they were trying to simulate water or something, but I don't know.
It just looked weird. Maybe it hasn't been remastered. I think maybe they need to remaster it for HD. Because I think that might have been part of the problem, is it looked great in 1989, and then you watch it on HDTV, and it just kind of looks off.
It's really strange.
Yeah.
And all the mer people are like, yeah, let's go to Atlantica and have a party. Well, they're going for a concert or something.
Yeah, concert. Specifically a concert.
King Triton rides in like a boss on his
dolphin thing.
Carriage, which I'm like, why do you can just swim.
There's this big performance. Well, why swim when somebody else can do it for you?
Do dolphins. That's abusive.
Even Sebastian got to ride in on guppies.
PETA! Yeah, I know he did.
So they have this big musical number where Ariel's supposed to show up in the middle and she's not there. She is out with Flounder exploring a shipwreck.
Yeah, because she loves all things human. She just loves all the things. She wants to collect all of the treasures.
She's a homophile.
And so they're in the shipwreck, and then of course a shark comes, and there's a chase scene where they have to run away from the shark.
And it's kind of just, you know, most of the time when something like this happens in a Disney movie, that shark's coming back, like, in Act 3, and we never saw the shark again.
No, of course not. You big bully. And they meet Scuttle.
And he evaluates Ariel's treasures. This is where we get the infamous Dingle Hopper for the fork being a hairbrush.
I mean, okay, he's kind of an annoying character.
Oh, he's fine. I was fine with Scuttle.
No, I was fine with him, but, like, he's kind of perfect, like, that guy who just almost like a hillbilly, and he's like, yeah, that's what this is, and blah, 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 but he doesn't know anything about what he's talking about.
Yeah.
Like, he's annoying, but he's also not annoying. I don't know.
I didn't find him annoying. I just thought he was a perfect BS character. I think more BS characters need to be in more movies and more things, because you always run into that BS person in your life. The person that's just bullshitting and...
they don't know anything.
Yeah.
And we meet, which is a good, we meet, the, you know, our villain, Ursula, pretty quickly, pretty right away, with her creepy little eels and her tentacles. And
yeah, those eels with the yellow, one yellow eye each is super creepy. And
flotsam and jetsam.
Gross, yeah. And she loves them.
Mm-hmm. Well, so she goes back because she realizes she missed the concert. And so her dad is just pissed. He's like, you embarrassed the family.
And they and down there, they call humans fish eaters.
They
so
are.
What do the merpeople eat if they don't eat other fish? Like, everything in the ocean eats fish, god damn it.
That is a great question. Maybe
maybe they're algae eaters?
Yeah,
I don't know.
They're vegan, so, you know, they just eat seaweed and algae, and that's why
whale poop.
That's why they're so thin. I mean.
Amber, what is it, Amber Glorist, or
whatever. Yeah, but what does Triton eat? Because he's, like, jacked. He's...
so are gorillas and they're vegan.
He's just doing like bench presses down below.
Yeah. Actually, he's magic, so that's just what he makes himself.
Oh yeah, he just points his little Triton and pumps up his muscles.
Yeah. You know, Ursula likes to look like a slob, but Triton likes to look jacked.
And I like at the beginning when she's like, oh, look at me, I'm wasting away to practically nothing.
And she's this big, fat octopus.
Yeah, she's amazing. And so Ariel's all, you can't talk to me that way, blah, blah, blah. And he's like, yes, I can. She runs away all sad.
Yeah, and then Sebastian is put in charge of her surveillance.
Teenagers, they think they know everything. You give them an inch, they swim all over you.
How do I get myself into these situations? I should be writing symphonies, not tagging along after some headstrong teenager.
He's voluntold to go and watch over her. And this is where we find Ariel's secret little treasure trove.
Her hoard.
Yeah, she's a hoarder. She's the OG hoarder. She's going to get stuck in there one day. It's all going to come crashing down.
Yeah, part of the walls are going to be rotten because stuff was stacked against it forever.
And there's just like flounder's poop everywhere.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's going to be gross.
there's like a dead flounder in, underneath something.
And then this is where we get the beginning of the Part of the World song.
Look at this stuff. Isn't it neat? Wouldn't you think my collection's complete? Wouldn't you think I'm the girl who has everything?
And she just has a human fetish. She's a homophile.
Well, yeah, she doesn't, at this point, it's not even about Eric, because she doesn't even know who he is.
She just likes people.
She just likes people, and that's the biggest problem.
She wants feet. She's got a foot fetish.
Yeah, exactly. That I have with people saying, oh, all she cares about is kissing the prince.
That is not true, yeah.
No, it's 100% not what her deal is. I mean, it is eventually because she's a 16-year-old girl and Eric's hot, so, you know, whatever, it's fine.
Well, yeah, I mean, so that's one of the other weird underlying things, is that this is basically a story about a bratty hormonal teenager.
Yeah.
And who gets her way, which is not probably correct.
I'm 16 years old. I'm not a child.
Probably not. But but I mean, is she really bratty, though? I mean, she just...
she's bratty because of her hormones.
But she's also a good person.
Hormones.
Yes. And after she sings the treasure song, she sees Sebastian. And she's like, oh my god, please don't tell dad. And he's like, ugh, I can't. But then she sees the boat go up and she sees the fireworks and she goes up and she's like, oh my god.
She's like leaning on the boat, like, I don't even know what to call that hole. Like, just a...
Oh, when she swims up and she's... Yeah, it's like a porthole,
but it's not a porthole. She's just leaning on one of the deck holes, which is weird. Like, how did she get all the way up to the deck?
She climbed. They showed her climbing.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, so she climbed up to the deck and she's just watching. The dog takes interest in her and licks her, and she's just like, oh my god, that was dope. And then she sees Prince Eric, and she's just immediately like, I want to fuck that guy.
I mean, now. In terms of hot Disney princes, he is the hottest. I'm just saying, like...
The dark hair and the blue eyes.
It's the bushy eyebrows. That's all that's all it is. But...
So he wouldn't work today because he'd need to be manscaped.
But no, he actually kind of has a personality in this movie, too, though. If you look at, like...
Does he? His personality is, oh, man, I'm waiting for this chick who's saying to me on the beach. No,
but I mean, he has a little bit more something to him than, like, the prince in Cinderella.
Sure, yeah.
Who doesn't even talk.
And on the boat, he gets a statue. Everybody wants him to get married, and he's like, no, man, I'm waiting for the right broad.
Oh, Eric, it isn't me alone. The entire kingdom wants to see you happily settled down with the right girl.
Oh, she's out there somewhere. I just haven't found her yet.
Well, perhaps you haven't been looking hard enough.
Oh, believe me, Grim, when I find her, I'll know. Without a doubt, it'll just, bam, hit me.
Yeah, he's a hopeless romantic.
And then out of nowhere, there's this gigantic effing storm, somehow right next to shore, but yet it completely shipwrecks them and fucks them up. Like, they're, like, almost home, and all of a sudden this storm just destroys their boat.
I don't know.
To the shore.
And it lights it on fire.
Yeah,
and
then, it lights on fire.
And this is a pretty dramatic scene, actually.
This is actually a pretty good scene.
I like this scene.
I do, too.
And because you're, like... I'm genuinely worried about the dog.
Yeah, yeah. He has to jump back on the ship to save Max.
Yeah. He loves animals. Yeah, he's a catch.
He throws him overboard. He gets stuck on the boat. And then the black powder keg blows up. And then everybody's like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God.
And then,
but Ariel goes and saves him.
Yeah, she's a hero.
Ariel's my hero.
That's literally what he does. Because then the next morning, he's just on the shore, and she's just, like, over him, and she's like, I'm just really obsessed with you.
Yeah, she's like, she's like trying to figure out how to rape him. She's like, well, yeah, how do I do this?
Yeah, I mean, we don't know the specifics of how mer people do that, but,
well,
you know.
Well, they're probably like fish. They probably lay eggs, and then the guy jacks off on the eggs.
Sure, yeah, exactly.
That's how fish do it.
Well, yeah, so she's like, where can I put my eggs? And so she's singing, you know, the reprise, and he, like,
part of your world,
wakes up halfway in the middle, and it's, you know, romantic and whatever, and then the dog comes, so she freaks out and swims away.
Ursula being like, oh, it's such an easy trap for me to set. She's in love with a human. She's so dumb.
Yeah, I mean, she's not wrong. She's like, it's too easy. This is so perfect. It's, yeah, so she's...
No, but I mean, really, how hard is it to trap a 16-year-old? In general.
Right.
You just, all you have to do is know what they like and then exploit that.
So Ariel is just swimming around like a crazy person. She's like, oh my God, I'm so in love. And
she's boy crazy.
She really is boy crazy. Like, so boy crazy.
And all of her sisters, which I could have used a little backstory there, like, are all like, oh, Dad, can't you tell she's boy crazy? Blah, 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 blah.
Well, I think you do get backstory in Little Mermaid 3, Ariel's Beginning. And that's, like, about her mom and what happened to her mom, apparently. Oh, I haven't seen that one, but...
Wow, let's never talk about that again. So, and then we get the banger.
Under the sea.
The big one.
Yeah, because Sebastian's like, you don't want to leave. This place is great, and I'm going to sing to you about it. Well, and it's the best part of the ride, the dark ride at California
it's
Adventure.
It's the best part of the movie. This song, that's why they play it again at the end of the movie.
When the boss get hungry,
yes, you go beyond the place.
What? Under the sea, under the sea. Nobody beat us, fry us, and eat us in fricassee. We want the land folks love to cook. Under the sea, we have the hook up. We got no trouble. Let me see bubbles under the sea.
Under the sea.
Under the sea.
Under the sea.
Since life is sweet here, we got to be here naturally.
Naturally.
Even the sturgeon and the ray.
Really good. It's just
Well, and just the lyrics are really clever, talking about all the different fish. The blowfish blow.
It's like Rock Lobster for a Disney movie.
Yeah, it's quite good. It's a good song. I'm not going to deny it. It's a great song.
It's one of the better Disney songs in any movie.
Yes, it's very catchy, very memorable. But Ariel doesn't care because Flounder's like, yo, I got a statue for you in your trove. Somehow I got it there all by myself.
Well, things are easier to move underwater. Nobody said nobody helped him. He just had it there.
That's true. Somebody could have helped him, but I just want to know who did.
Daisy the Dolphin.
Yo, Daisy, come here.
We see her in Little Mermaid 4.
Ariel's dead.
Flounder's just remembering her, like, oh, remember days of my birthday.
And he's like old flounder and he's got a beard and his fish are like, your little grand fish his are like, okay,
scales are kind of sloughing off.
Yeah. He's got a little fish cane.
Yeah. So, at the end of that scene, though, of the under the sea, when he finds it, she runs off. Sebastian says, someone has to nail that girl's fins to the floor.
Yeah, it's a good line.
Yeah, it
it's
is.
And then he gets summoned by the king, because the king's like, oh, Sebastian will know who she's
in love with. Yeah, and he kind of narks about humans.
Yeah, because Triton is like, oh, I know you've been keeping something from me, and he's all nervous, and he just blurts it out on accident.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Ariel's all like, oh, talking to the statue, and she's just like, oh, 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 oh.
Yeah, she's basically masturbating to the statue.
Yeah, I mean, she's all about it.
If you want to be real about it, I mean, she was about 21 seconds from making out with it and rubbing herself against it in a weird way.
She was in love with it. Because it's a very typical teenage girl. That's what she would do.
Yeah.
And then her dad shows up, and it's a horrific scene.
He's really angry. He's mad. And he does what every parent should never do. Don't destroy and break shit trying to be cool. That's only just super abusive, horrible, and destructive.
Yeah, this is a horrible scene. Like, it's really upsetting.
Yeah.
I don't like it.
He blows everything up. He destroys everything. He destroys Eric the statue.
Except for his face. It's like a perfect cutout of his face.
Apparently. I mean, that could have just been put back together by Ursula to
That's true. But, yeah, I hate this. And he feels bad, like, immediately after, and then he just swims away.
He's like, well, I feel bad, but I'm the king, so I'm always right.
I'm gonna go do some more push-ups. Yeah. With my grandpa beard. And then Flotsam and Jetsam come, and they're all like, oh, blah, 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 Ursula can help you. And she's like, no. And they're like, okay, suit yourself. And then she's kidding.
Yeah, they lure her to Ursula. Sebastian should go tell Triton right now.
Exactly.
The movie would be over.
It would be.
He would have come. He would have killed her. It would have been the end.
But no. And then, of course, Ariel's like, should I go inside? And I'm like, girl, you're like, this is seriously sketch. There's all these, like, little gross things on, like,
these little dead souls that are entrapped, that are trying to stop you from going.
They're literally pulling on her, like, don't go in there.
Yeah.
But she's, you know, she's like a person in a horror movie that runs up the stairs. Like, just not smart at all. We get also, I really like Ursula's
The Poor Unfortunate Soul song. Yeah, this is a pretty good song. I forget about this.
Yeah, it's a good, I like a good villain song. And it's,
well, I do too. And but they didn't let it run long enough, I feel like. It should have gotten a little more pop.
Yeah, it's a little bit short. I remembered it being longer. I don't know.
But that might have been like on one of your sing-along things.
There could have been an extended version. Yeah. Director's cut.
Poor unfortunate souls in pain, in need. This one longing to be thinner. That one wants to get the girl. And do I help them?
Yes, indeed.
Those poor unfortunate souls, so sad, so true. They come flocking to my cauldron, crying, spells, Ursula, please, and I help them.
Yes, I do.
But no, I like this part because I like a lot of these songs in Disney movies because they're communicating a lot of information.
Right.
And it naturally fits into the flow of the movie. It's a musical. I mean,
any of these movies like this that don't have a villain song, they've done something very wrong.
Yeah, you gotta have a villain song.
I think that might have been the problem, and I might be totally misremembering this, with the David Spade one.
Oh, yeah. No, you're right.
I don't think they had a villain song.
Emperor's New Groove. There's no villain song.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of where that movie fell flat.
They didn't really have a ton of songs in that movie in general.
Well, right. That's kind of the problem.
No, the villain, she's great because you...
Yeah, great villain, but no song makes it, like, weird.
Oh, in Emperor's. Yeah. No, yeah, they really could have had one in that, too. It would have made, like, a lot of sense.
Yeah, because... It's not like Eartha Kitt can't sing.
Because that whole time when she's talking about what she, like, sorry, sidebar, but when she's talking about what she wants to do to Kuzco, that could have been into, like, a song about all the horrible things she wants to do to him.
Right, right. Could have been good.
Missed opportunity. Yep. Ariel, like a freaking idiot, is like, yeah, I'll give you my voice. Like, what? You're going to be living as a mute the rest of your life?
Yeah, this is something that makes no sense. It's like, here you are, like, the star voice person. You're like, oh, yeah, I'll do it. But it also makes sense because she's a dumb teenager who can't think of 5 seconds in the future.
Yeah, she's just like, yeah, Eric, oh, I get to be a human. Oh, yeah, double whammy. This is great. And
so she signs her life away, and now she's a human who cannot talk, and she's on the beach.
And I love from when Ursula transforms her into a human, like the whole Ursula's part, and then just all of the stuff where she's first learning, like, kind of how to be a human. I love this whole segment. Yeah, I love all of it. It's a
good part.
And
yeah, because at first she's stumbling around the beach with Sebastian and Flounder, and I keep forgetting the seagull's name.
Scuttle.
It's cute and it's funny, but then Eric shows up, so they dress her up in a sail.
He recognizes her at first. He's like, oh, it's you, but then she doesn't talk, so he's like, but, oh.
And then he's like pointing to her throat, like, you wouldn't get it, like, really?
Something happened to her?
Yeah.
No, but he's like, oh, couldn't have been you. Oh, second rate, but you're still hot, so come with me. Yeah. But so he takes her back, and she, you know, the castle crew is taking care of her.
Yeah, they wash her up, they make her extra hot.
But I just love when Sebastian basically, by circumstance, gets plopped down in the kitchen.
Well, he gets washed first, yeah. Which I think is funny. He gets laundered. Well, then he gets plopped into the kitchen into this hilarious scene with the chef.
So when he's getting laundered, low-key, the ladies, what they're actually saying is really funny.
It is very funny,
because they're,
yeah,
like, that's not my idea of a princess. And she's like, if Eric's looking for a girl, I've got a couple of highly available ones right here.
Yeah. They're basically townie bitches jealous of the hot, washed-up girl.
Yeah, it's pretty good. Yeah, the hilarious scene in the kitchen with the song, the Le Poisson, that's easily one of my favorite parts of the movie.
Yeah, that's kind of low-key good.
It's great. It's like, cut off the head, then I rip out the bones.
And it's very funny how Sebastian's horrified by the whole thing.
Yeah, he's horrified because he sees him chopping up stuff, and he's like, oh, what, Sarah, what is this? How now could I miss such a sweet little succulent? I'll stuff you with bread. It don't hurt because you're dead. I love all of it, and their battle throughout the kitchen and the whole thing, and it's amazing. I really love that part.
And even though he ends up on the plate.
He does end up on the plate, and while all this is going on,
poor Triton is beside himself about his dog.
Yeah, he's like, oh, what have I done? I'm so sad. And Eric is beside himself. He's like, damn, you clean up well. You look nice.
He's like, oh. Mm. But then they agree to go on a silent tour of the kingdom the next day.
Yeah, and they do all the nonsense. And the best part of it is when he lets her drive, and she's like, okay.
She goes over the cliff, yeah.
And he's, like, terrified, and she's having a great time.
Yeah.
It's my favorite part.
And then, so that ends in the scene with the kiss the girl, blah, 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 where Sebastian gets the whole
bayou, or...
Not bayou, but lagoon.
Yeah.
Singing and...
Sha-la-la-la-la, my oh my, look like the boy too shy.
But then, obviously, Ursula has to ruin it, because she would have lost right then and there.
And I kind of actually 100% forgot about this song, but I really
totally,
do.
Yeah.
I do love it. It's a good song.
The song is okay, but it's a good part. But they almost kiss.
Yeah, and he's Ursula such a pussy. If he would have kissed her, it would have all been better. Although she would have been a mute forever, so I don't know.
Well, no, there was something they were saying that she was going to get her voice back if he kissed her.
No, she was going to stay a human.
No, in the song, bro, in the song, it said that.
Oh, I guess it does, but I don't think that's true, though, because Ursula had her voice in the little shell thing. I don't know.
Just saying, I'm just throwing it out there.
It's true. Maybe they were confused. They were just hopeful.
But the next scene after that is Eric is still out looking for the singing girl. He's out there with his little horn, or his little flute. Little skinny flute.
His skin flute.
Yeah. Skinny little skin flute. Blowing it around.
And Grimsby's like, yo, forget about this girl that you...
You've got a hot redhead that doesn't say anything. What are you doing?
Pretty much. But then Ursula... basically transformed herself into a semi-lookalike of Ariel, but with brown hair.
Just a brunette hottie,
yeah,
with the voice.
But she has her voice. So then Eric... But she's actually hypnotized him.
She's a succubus.
Into a trance. And so he's like, oh god, I gotta marry this bitch.
Yeah, she enchants him. And he's like, oh, we gotta get married tonight. Right away. There's a scene where everybody's crying. Flounder and Ariel.
Yeah, Ariel's devastated.
Sebastian and Scuttle. Everybody's devastated.
Yeah. Because they all are like, oh, yeah.
Oh, my God.
So
oh,
cute.
No. Oh, the brown-haired girl. Oh.
The loveliest bride.
The loveliest bride.
But then Scuttle is, like, flying around, and he sees...
Ursula in the mirror.
In the mirror, and he's like, oh my god, I gotta go tell them, and he successfully does. So then everybody springs into action to stop the wedding.
Everybody has to rally all the animals. They stop the wedding after Ursula kicks Max, which is a horrible part of the scene.
Yeah, I kind of forgot about that, because she's walking down the aisle and she just, like, kicks him with her heel. He'd be well,
because
like,
he's growling.
Yeah.
Because he knows that she's bad.
He hates her.
Yeah.
And through all the kerfuffle of sea creatures jumping on her and everyone going crazy, Ariel's able to make it on top of the ship, and then her voice gets returned to her, and Eric is broken out of his trance, and he's like, it is you, I knew it. Did you, though?
Yeah.
You're feeling better, Ocho.
But he still fails to kiss her in time.
Before the sun goes down.
Because he's a dumbass. He's like, oh, I gotta talk to you before I stick my tongue down your throat. Oh, no, you're a fish. But then, so then Ursula and Ariel go back down to the sea. Under the sea.
But not a happy time this time.
And Eric goes after her, and there's this epic sea fight that takes place.
Well, and in before that, though, her dad, like, gets turned, he agrees to, like, switch places with her on the contract, so he gets turned into, like, a little, like, wormy thing.
And she gets the trident and the crown.
That's because that's what she wants.
Yeah.
It's, and then Eric, like, swims under and manages to harpoon her under the water somehow.
No,
at first. And then he's trying to swim away. But
he just kind of cuts her. He nicks her.
Yeah, really. But the big battle, she just gets all mad and turns into, like, raging Hulk Ursula.
Gigantic, like, 8-story tall Ursula.
And her voice turns into this.
Well, it would if you were that much bigger.
You pitiful, insignificant fool.
But Eric pilots one of the ships that she brings back up from the bottom and rams its broken mast right through her dark little fucking heart.
It's amazing.
And kills her. Electrical things. And then all of the souls at the bottom of the sea are freed.
Yeah.
So all these merpeople pop up. The trident and the crown fall right back onto Triton. So he's right back in charge.
Yeah, he's like a boss. I didn't do anything.
He's like, nobody ever even saw me do the worm thing. What are you talking about?
I was never that. I've always been jacked.
Yeah, I'm always a worm. I'm always Triton. What? No.
photos or it didn't happen.
Yeah. But then Triton, he sees that Ariel's truly in love, so he makes her a human. And basically, happily ever after.
Yeah, and they get married, and, you know, then just they have the goodbye, and
there's one little hilarious Sebastian Chef Louis thing.
Of course, yeah. And then it's the end of the movie. Everything is happy and wonderful.
Now we can walk, now we can run, now we can stay all day in the sun.
Yeah, Happily Ever After. AGA.
I mean, I like all the songs in this movie. I really do.
Under the Sea.
Besides Under the Sea, because you have the obviously the villain song we talked about.
Yeah, which is really good.
The chef song, Le Poisson. The Kiss the Girl song, which I really like. Part of Your World, which I love.
That's a good song. I think Part of Your World's a good song.
And then the two short little Daughters of Triton at the beginning, and then the Fathoms Below intro song. But I think it's good. I mean, this was their first, I guess Oliver and Company did have a lot of songs too. This was the first formula into the movie musical that they...
Well, right. The biggest difference is that one had a whole bunch of celebrities and this one didn't.
That is true. And this was better, so...
And same with Aladdin and kind of Lion King. The better animated movies don't have a bunch of celebrities
in them. I mean, but they do have, though, like... I mean...
A bunch.
Well, the end, they have some.
Well, I mean, with Aladdin, they had Robin Williams,
Well, but Lion King, they had a lot of celebrities, actually.
Well, they had, yeah, but not celebrities, voice celebrities, other than JTT, that was kind of, did a good job.
Well, and James Earl Jones.
Well, James Earl Jones is a voice celebrity, though. Okay. He's known for his voice more than anything else.
Speaking of Lion King, so Matthew Broderick, adult Simba,
which is one of the weakest things.
No, but he they wanted him to play Prince Eric, and he didn't want to.
Yeah, he would not be good at it.
No, he's too,
he's got too much of a bitch voice. I mean,
I don't know. Yeah. It's not right. But I just had another fun
little
fact.
He's too shrill. That's what I mean. Think about him in an election. He's very shrill.
Yeah, you need a man. I mean, and this movie has a lot of characters, too, though. I mean, it's...
Yeah, you have Ariel, the bratty hormonal teen.
I don't think she's bratty. I really don't.
I do. I think she's a little bratty.
I think she's a very lovable character.
Because she has a daddy who wants to hand the world to her. Like, she can't even show up to the concert for her own coming out.
I know. That's pretty bad. It's pretty bad.
It's bratty. And then we have Eric, the foot fetish sea creature weirdo prince guy.
Sea creature weirdo?
He's got some issues.
I mean... No, because he fell in love with her. She saved his life, and he didn't know she was a mer person at that point.
I'm not even saying that she's a mer. That it's a mer person. He's just a little. He's a little off kilter.
He's, you know, he's just you cut him some slack. He's a good prince.
We've got Triton, who's the stereotypical dad.
Yeah, good old asshole dad. Is what
Don't you take that tone of voice with me, young lady. Well, as long as you live under my ocean, you'll obey my rule.
But if you would just listen.
Not another word.
I'm a dad.
Go bench press. He's, you know what he's like? Because he just has his little mer tail. He's like on Family Guy, the guy in the wheelchair that's all buff.
Yeah, Patrick Warburton.
Yeah, he's like that. Yeah.
Let's see here. Oh, and then we have Ursula, the nastiest, one of the better villains.
Fuck yeah. She is one of my favorite villains. Yeah. She is, I just love her so
Because you
much.
See her and you're like, oh my god, no, she's terrible.
No, she's fabulous.
I mean, terrible. Terrible. She's a good villain.
And Sebastian.
Sebastian's a great side character. Really, really, truly a great side character.
Yeah, because both of the songs that he does are really good in the movie.
Flounder,
so.
The worst side character.
Yeah, he's just meh. Just kind of there. I
just didn't remember that. I didn't really remember Flounder being a zero.
Yeah, he's really just kind of there. Not really.
Max is a better character than
Max is Flounder. Pretty cute. Yeah. What if Max was like the shaggy dog? Remember? The same kind of dog?
Yeah.
It's all connected. So that's him from before. Because, you know, he lives through time. So that's him. That's the OG shaggy dog. So really,
I'm going to say that this is part of that.
No, because at the beginning, when Scuttle's like, when she's like, I've never seen a human. Isn't this close? Isn't he beautiful? And Scuttle's like, I don't know. He looks kind of hairy and slobbery. And she's like, not that one.
That so he's actually a human.
He is actually a human because he's Shaggy Dog. I'm just saying.
It's actually Grimsby.
So Grimsby's actually a dog?
Yeah, he's actually... Well, no, he's just actually this shaggy...
Yeah, that's hilarious. But yeah, so there you go. It's all connected.
He has the same problem as Merlin Jones. It's no big deal.
All connected. The animation, I mean, we've talked about a little bit, just it was kind of strange in parts.
It's not the best, but then again, this is also the last film painted cell Disney movie that was ever done. As much as we're like, oh, it looks a little weak, it's just because that's the style that it was.
Well, and for the time, it was like, if you imagine seeing this for the time, you're probably like, holy shit.
Well, in the movie theater, it looked good. And on your VHS, it looked good. I think they just need to digitally remaster to make it look good on Disney Plus.
Yeah, it just wasn't. It was mainly that beginning part was really strange. Like,
I really felt like the whole thing needed a little help.
Well, and just, like, the colors of, like, the characters versus the backgrounds are really strange.
That's what I'm saying. They could do, I'm not even saying, like, a full digital makeover, but just a small digital touch-up to make it look good today.
100%. Did you get any quotable lines there, David?
Someone has to nail that girl's fins to the floor. I really like that line.
It's a good line. I had, wonderful, let's eat before this crab wanders off my plate. And also, the tagline, one of the taglines for this movie, see it.
No.
S-E-A. No. See it.
Surprising things. I was just a little disappointed that there was a little less substance than I wanted for this movie. Which is fine. It did lose a little pointage for it, but I forgot that it didn't have a lot of substance.
Yeah, I mean, I still love the movie. I always will. But people talk about this movie like it's one of the greatest Disney movies ever
made.
And
it's not.
It is good. I really love it.
It's not one of the greatest.
It's not. In my opinion, it's not as good as Mulan. It's not as good as Hercules. And it's not as good as Pocahontas.
Well, it's definitely not as good as Mulan. I haven't seen the other two.
I know, but I'm just saying, like, those are...
And it's not as good as Aladdin or Lion King.
Aladdin and Lion King are in their own category. Aladdin, Lion King, and Beauty and the Beast are in their own category. But I'm just saying that, like compared to Pocahontas and Hercules and Mulan, which are three movies that literally get no credit.
Right.
And all three of those, in my opinion, are better than this movie. The animation is better. Just 'cause
it has James Woods.
Has so much more than that. I can't, I'm sweating thinking about it. But, yeah. So I was a little disappointed just because I did love this movie so much, and I still love it. A little bit of nostalgia for me, but I still really do. It's a good movie. Makes me feel good. It puts you in a good mood.
All right. So would you remake anything about this movie?
They're coming out with another one in 2023, so...
Yeah, I don't mean a live-action garbage.
Maybe putting a little more substance into it.
That's what I said. I could have done with a little bit more backstory, a little bit more world building. Just round it out. Make it an hour and 39 minutes instead of an hour and 27 minutes.
Yeah, that could have been good. But I mean, in terms of final thoughts, it's a classic Disney movie. It's great for kids. All kids love this movie.
Well, and I really think especially it's great for girls.
Because girls love
like, this is like the ultimate girl animated Disney movie.
Especially girls my age. There was no girl who didn't go lay on a rock and lift herself up and go, "Ah, Ariel." Like, that's what you freaking do. Or you're like try to comb your hair with a fork. It's just what you do.
So how did that work out?
For me, because of my big mop head, it's not right. But for some people that have like pin straight hair, it works fine. And they're like, "Yeah, I'm Ariel." And I'm like, "Fuck you, Julie."
For somebody who could run like a stick through their hair and it would be no problem. All right, Kelly.
Wait, hold on. Ooh, 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 budget.
Sorry, in ratings. Yeah, whoa.
Whoa.
Whoa, 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 whoa.
Ahead of himself.
Well, and final thoughts. I mean, okay, so budget, $40 million. How much money did it make?
$211 million.
And I think that's low. I don't think that that's
They're
right.
They're not factoring in merchandise sales. Like, in terms of merchandise, I bet this movie has more, a ton.
Almost anything else,
because
yeah.
Think about all those little, like, Barbie dolls and the,
every
like,
little
everything.
Thing from 1990 until today.
Is every little girl wants to be a mermaid. It's just
yeah,
a thing.
Yeah, yeah. So what do you think the Rotten Tomatoes score for this movie is?
I mean, it's got to be super high. I'm going to guess like a 97%.
So with the critics, it's 93.
Okay.
And with the people, it's 88. So I think it actually kind of falls into not the greatest Disney movie territory.
Yeah, but a lot of people really like
good,
it.
Good. Everybody. So with Rotten Tomatoes, you know, good is good, and that's what counts. But it's not the best.
Yeah, it's not a rock star.
Right.
It's like the opening act.
Well, maybe middle act.
Middle act, yeah.
Or maybe a low, it's still a headliner, but maybe like small scenes.
It's like middle of the day at a music festival. Second, not quite the evening.
Second to last.
Second to last at a music festival.
There yeah, second to last. So what is your rating for this movie?
So I really love this movie, but it didn't quite reach the top percentile. So I just went with... The year it came out, I gave it an 89%.
Wow, that is still extremely high. Holy crap.
You know, 8.9 out of 10 seashells. It's, you know, it's...
So I think I gave this the top dude rating I could do at 76%.
That's fair. I think for
like
me...
Like, it's very good. I can't complain about any of it, but I...
It's just okay.
I'm not going to get excited about
it. But, like, I could easily just have it on in the background while I'm doing something and be... perfectly okay with it, because there's no part of this movie that's bad. Like,
no, you're right, there's not. So now it's time, favorite part of the podcast.
Is it
and we get number 146.
Not Hercules.
Tune in next week to see if it's Hercules.
Literally, once we get it, I don't know what I'm going to do with myself, but that's okay. Oh, God. David made a horrible face. I don't like that.
Okay, so do you have a guess?
Okay, so what was the number?
186.
So, is this in the 80s?
Yeah.
Oh, 80s Disney. That's a rough period of time. I feel like we've already watched all the 80s animation movies.
It's not an.
Is it? I don't even know what live action came out in the 80s. Okay, what is it?
So number 146 is from 1981. Amy.
Like A-M-Y?
A-M-Y, Amy. I don't know if this is correct. I don't know if this is a real movie. It's between Herbie Goes Bananas and Fox and the Hound, but it doesn't seem right to just have Amy. And if it is right, oh boy, Amy.
Amy! No, this is drama.
Amy!
And it's on Disney Plus, so it's...
So, I'm going to say that this is about some chick who doesn't play by the rules of being a girl. And she's like a rebel without a cause, but like kind of masculine. But yet she falls in love with this boy who kind of understands her.
A boy or a man?
Either way.
A
banana, a boing, bang,
so
boy.
I'm going to say she is like... a child musical prodigy. And she's like, no, I didn't look at it. I promise. I didn't look at it. And
oh, wait, it's a drama.
Yeah. I'm thinking like Mr. Holland's Opus type movie, but she's like a little kid. And then like she plays like the harp or flute or something. And her mom's like, or one of her parents is like, you must do it. And she's like, I don't want to, but I'm a prodigy, blah, blah, blah.
I'm going to say that there's a highly inappropriate statutory scene in this movie because it's in 1981.
Like on Napoleon and Samantha with the creepy serial killer guy?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Who, there's like, ties him up?
There's going to be definitely some of those vibes in this movie somewhere.
Maybe she gets lost in a mall. Somebody steals her or something. And there's going to be a Michael Douglas type that has to rescue her.
I think we'd be lucky to get Michael Douglas in this movie. So yeah, next week, Amy, if you'd like to send us an email at disneyoddpod@gmail.com.
Like, subscribe, share. If you feel so inclined, please give us those 5 stars on your favorite podcast platform. Woo-hoo. That would be groovy.
If you want to follow us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Disney Odd Pod. So this has been Disney Odd Pod.
I'm Kat.
I'm D.
Bye! Tastes good.
Liquor mouth.
Good. Final in a minute, so.
Ari. Ari. Ari.
Ari. Yeah, Luke, you gotta sit down away from the mic, buddy.
He's fine, as long as he's not licking.
Yeah, good luck.
You lint licker.
Is it really bad?
Oh, it's gross.
Well, then pick it up.
It goes, like, up the wall. No, I'm not picking that up with my hands. You fucking, no. It's like a thing of cat hair like this long.